to extend a warm welcome to everyone who joined in our humble initiative. I'd like to brief about the university and the guest speaker now. Srimati Nathibai Damodar Thakur Se Women's University is the first women's university in Southeast Asia. The university was founded by Maharishi Dr. Nondu Keshav Karve in 1916 for the noble cause of women's education. The university headquarters is in Churchgate campus, Mumbai, and the other two campuses of this university are at Juhu, Mumbai, and Karve Road, Pune. SNDT Women's University can affiliate with colleges or institutions anywhere in India with prior consent from the state government. SNDT Women's University stands 32nd amongst multidisciplinary universities of India, ranked 4th in Western India according to the Week Hansa Research Ranking of 2020. The University Department of Political Science was established in 1984, committed to providing quality education with a view of creating strong, motivated, and determined women political scientists committed to social justice and gender empowerment. The department offers intellectually stimulating programs that encourages research and critical thinking on contemporary political issues with a view of creating socially responsible and politically aware citizens. The department has a strong and committed faculty with national and international exposure interested in creating an enabling environment for research and academic. The students of the department who come from across the country bring diversity and plurality to the classroom. The department organizes academic and cultural activities, inviting the best academicians, activists, and practitioners from the country and abroad. And one such academic activity is the monthly lecture series, which aims to provide a unique experience to students, teachers, and scholars of different specializations. This is our second monthly lecture, and Dr. Ajay Gudavarti has honored us with his presence for this month. Dr. Ajay Gudavarti is an assistant professor at the Center for Political Studies of Jawaharlal Nehru University, New Delhi. Dr. Ajay taught earlier as assistant professor at the National Law School of India University, Bangalore. He had been a visiting fellow, Center for Citizenship, Civil Society and Rule of Law, University of Aberdeen in 2012. He was a visiting faculty at Center for Human Rights, University of Hyderabad, and at Goldsmith College, University of London in 2011, and a Charles Wallace Fellow at the School of Oriental and African Studies, University of London in 2008. Dr. Ajay's areas of research interest include political theory, contemporary political movements, post-colonial theory, and debates on civil society. His latest book is India After Modi, Populism and the Right. Apart from his academic writings, he is a regular contributor to News Daily, including The Hindu, Indian Express, Deccan Herald, among others. On behalf of the Political Science Department at SNDT Women's University, I'd like to welcome Dr. Ajay Gudavarti amongst us today. Welcome, sir.
Okay. Am I audible? Is that clear, Manisha?
Yes. It's clear. Just one correction. Jeevita, Professor Gudavarti is Associate Professor with Center for Political Studies, Jawaharlal Nehru University. So that's just one thing that needed to be put on record.
Sorry, apologies from my side.
No, you don't have to apologize. The way things are going in JNU, you might prove to be prescient and we might become assistant back again very soon. So anyways.
Okay, let me just Ajay, just give me a minute so that I'll put this entire lecture in the context and then you can start off. I was reading the New York Times and David Brooks says the world is on fire, and we can literally witness that from Capitol Hill in Washington to Ghazipur and Singhu border. Protests seems to dominate the civic and political imaginations all over the world. And protest is an important measure of discontent within the society, and it must also be viewed as an alternate form of politics. And in periods such as now, which is highly uncertain, protests can question incumbent regimes, amplify tension, leading to crisis and in extreme cases, collapse. Most of the times, protests are, you know, since 89, protests have been backlash against global democratic capitalism and have manifested in various economic and cultural crashes. However, we need to probably look at protest not merely, you know, many different kinds of protests are emerging, and while some protests were anti-establishment, other protests now, which are increasingly emerging, seem to question the new populist regimes that are all over the place. And most of these protests, including the Yellow Vests in France and the farmers' movement in India, are leaderless. So it's unrealistic to expect that they would have agendas or policy agendas. But then one needs to question whether protests are an indication of a broken social contract. Are they indicative of broken institutions, sectarian, divided society, and exclusions that have come to pervade our social and political ground? And under the context, is a middle ground available? And of course, the big question, what comes next? What after the protest? So to discuss on all these, we have with us Professor Ajay Gudavarti, and we are indeed very, very fortunate to have him with us. He's been writing, you know, he's writing, I think I see one column every day from Ajay. He's writing in a far more rapid pace than we can read, probably. And I'm sure we are indeed honored to have him with us. Welcome, Ajay, and look forward to listening to you.
Thanks, Manisha. Thanks for that warm introduction, and thanks to the students for organizing this. So what I wish to really focus on is, as Manisha has already sort of put two things on table in terms of understanding current populism, populist turn to Indian democracy, what does it essentially mean in terms of populism? And how should one make sense of politics under populist democracy? What are the frames through which one can make sense of protest politics? Because we have had different kinds of protests. So what I essentially would do is to focus on the anti-CA movement that happened last winter and the current farmers movement that's happening this winter. And comparing these two movements, what does it actually tell us, you know, about how should one possibly theorize protest and resistance? Why certain protests, in one sense, get accepted where the regime, as we are seeing with the farmers, of course, things are changing very fast as we go along, was and perhaps continues to be willing to sort of negotiate, enter into talks, while with another kind of a protest like the anti-CA protest, the state and the regime was much more forthright in terms of condemning, in terms of marginalizing, and even in terms of using blatant violence. Both were protests against unjust laws, both used certain kinds of protest means. Both were essentially very non-violent, but yet, why does this happen? That how does one theorize this kind of a differentiated response of the state to different kinds of protests? Most of you must have followed that student protests have been taking place, and even on that front, I think especially with JNU, state did not budge. In terms of using violence and in terms of sort of putting a block and blocking the entire mobilizational process. So this needs some amount of conceptualization, that why state comes under pressure at certain point and why the narratives that state creates in another context don't work. In some contexts they seem to work, in some contexts the same audience, same receivers, same quote unquote Hindu population group don't seem to accept the narratives so effectively. So we have to make some sense of these differences. So to understand that, we'll have to begin with what exactly is populism all about, and what is so distinct about this phenomena of populism under modern democracy. There are various ways of theorizing this phenomena. Many feel it's actually a thin theory, but let me point to a few central aspects of what comes to be referred to as populism, and why it is relevant for us to understand, and how does it get related to protest and things of that kind. Let me go over it one by one so that it becomes clear as to what I'm attempting to do here. Populism is a kind of a moralization of politics. It is a certain kind of a collapse between what is moral and what is political. They come much closer. They're always there's a certain tension, but I think populism brings a certain moral view of politics, and this morality is about who is an authentic people. Who are the authentic people in a democracy? And that authenticity is a kind of a manufactured authenticity. That they are the ones who can morally claim the nation, who can morally claim a certain sense of belonging. Therefore, populism uses emotions. It mobilizes emotions in a much direct mode. Unlike, we are comparing populism with liberal democracy. So liberal democracy, for instance, if you compare the two, I think this should make things easy for all of you to understand. That liberalism believes in governance by undermining emotion, and pushing emotions back to the private domain, by undermining emotions under liberal procedures, institutional norms, through the ideas of the public sphere, civility, so on and so forth. While in contrast, populism directly invokes and mobilizes emotions, gut feelings, intuitions, private emotions, which would therefore also by default include private prejudices, so on and so forth. Populism is also very high on symbolic valuation. Liberal democracy is more about a different kind of procedural communication. So you can compare, an easy way to make sense is comparing Manmohan Singh with Mr. Narendra Modi. That mode or method of communication of Mr. Manmohan Singh was very basic, was in terms of very procedural, very preset, things of that kind. But in populism, what happens is that symbolism is very proactively mobilized. In other words, everything that is done, everything that is stated has a certain kind of a symbolic value. That's the reason what we often refer in popular parlance, we say it's all about building certain perception. So you all must be hearing this on media everywhere that it is a perception. Yes, perception, but then perception is an indispensable part of modern complex society. Every act has to be interpreted. There is nothing given, that every act, every kind of political, what is politically involved, is interpreted. It is not ready. In modern complex societies, this becomes more complex because there are always multiple interpretations of the same process. And therefore, it is one interpretation against the other. It is not about something being just idealistic and something being material. That those material processes, like what we are witnessing today, how should one interpret the actions, the intentions of what farmers are doing? In modern complex societies, therefore, it's always open to this kind of a multiple interpretation. And that's what makes the process complex. Third, populism invokes on everyday interactions. It's more like an everyday interaction rather than, it's a top-down. State is not a distant entity anymore. So in a sense, populism breaks the public-private demarcation. Therefore, you can see in Mr. Modi's communication, it's like the everyday language. It's without jargon, it's without niceties. It is a way we perhaps sit and communicate in our drawing rooms. So it's easy. And therefore, populism becomes, it at least produces an optic of being very organic, thinking like the common man. Thinking like the common people on the streets, who do not prejudge the normative value of what they do. And therefore, normative valuation is very fungible, is inconsistent, so on and so forth. And finally, populism is about extra institutional mobilization. It is about street mobilization. It is about mobilizing the mob. It is about creating certain majorities. It can use the rhetoric of anti-establishment. It can invoke the rhetoric of anti-elitism, so on and so forth. So in one sense, populism is, to put it in a kind of a dramatic fashion, one could say that populism is a kind of a protest movement in governance, that governance itself becomes a kind of a protest, that you are governing against a certain kind of an imagined elite, a certain kind of a system, a certain kind of a class, a certain kind of elite, so on and so forth. So this distinction between opposition and system, between protest and governance, sort of to a certain extent collapses. That therefore you can see Mr. Modi himself is like a walking protest. He's a protest against the ills of the Congress in the past. He's a protest against elitism, against dynasty, against many things. So he is almost like a leader of the opposition. Therefore, you'll always see when people have questions about his governance or policies, he will put it back on Congress, so on and so forth. So he almost behaves like he's a leader of the opposition. So populism allows you the way it understands. So what is central, what is common to all of you? I can go on many other features, but let me pause here. So what is the strength of this kind of a populist governance? To my mind, is that it governs through a certain common symbol by appealing to certain kind of a normative universality. It appeals to certain moral values, certain public ethics, which the populist, to my mind, the right-wing populist in India, understand what and how these public ethics and public morals come to be. Something that, to make it easy, something that Romila Thapar in a recent book on dissent makes a very interesting point. And something similar I'm attempting here, that she makes this point that Hinduism as a religion got constructed over a period of time, but in course of that construction, dissent was always part of Hinduism's functioning and imagination. Therefore, she argues that we might have begun with Vedic Hinduism of the Brahmins, which was exclusionary, which was top down, which had practices of untouchability. It invoked the Vedic Brahminical practices. But she says over a period, we had Puranic Hinduism, which was more in terms of co-opting from local nativist, provincial, tribal practices. For instance, I and Manisha, we all visited this temple in Ujjain when we were there for a seminar, where the offering to a god in the Ujjain temple is liquor. Of course, now they are selling Indian modern this manufactured liquor. They're giving all kinds of whiskies and things like that. That is the offering. Now, how do you explain? That's because the local tribal practices, where tribals must be consuming some form of a local liquor, is co-opted as a Hindu practice. So that's one reason why Hinduism has such diverse, such self-contradictory practices. Somewhere they are meat-eating Brahmins, somewhere they are fish-eating Brahmins. In Uttarakhand and many parts of the north, Brahmins are meat-eating. In much of south, they are all vegetarian. And there are multiple sects within Brahmins, Madhavs, Vaishnavites, Shaivites. So there are multiple sects, so on and so forth. So she argues that all this happened because there was an internal dissent, and Hinduism went on co-opting those different forms. The third form, she says, is the Bhakti movement. So she also talks about the Shramik culture. Along with the Brahmanic Hinduism, you had the Shramik culture, referring to Buddhism, to Kabir, and so on and so forth, which talked in terms of privileging manual labor over mental labor, of production, productive process, which was materialist, which had which bordered on atheism, which was against idol worship, so on and so forth. So the entire, in one sense, historical conflict was between Hinduism and Brahmanism, and Brahmanism kind of so there was a tension, how they were co-opting, how they were trying to co-opt each other, how they were trying to outdo each other, and so on and so forth. And this dissent, Romila argues, was essentially about non-violence, was in terms of undoing hierarchies, exclusion, so on and so forth. And then she comes to a very important point that she says, when Gandhi invoked Satyagraha, and when Gandhi invoked non-violence, and Gandhi invoked symbols of ascetism, celibacy, brahmacharya, vegetarianism, cow worship, all of this Gandhi invoked, she argues that people responded so spontaneously in such big numbers. And I think that was one reason why Tagore referred to Gandhi as Mahatma, is because of the simple genius of understanding what constitutes collective subconscious. The collective subconscious, Romila argues, had this idea of dissent, but that dissent had a specific form. It was non-violent. It was about satyagraha. It was about truth. It was about self. It had certain kind of a religious symbolism attached to it. It was about combining everyday lifestyle issues of food, clothing, with protest politics. So Gandhi kind of mapped the entire civilizational history, Romila argues, through the kind of strategy that he manufactured. And therefore, there was such unmediated, spontaneous kind of a response to his mode of protest, of satyagraha, his ideas of non-violence, so on and so forth. So this is precisely what I'm trying to understand, that even in the current context, every protest, therefore, works in this kind of a symbolic field. It works in this kind of a field which is filled with cultural codes. which is filled with certain symbolism, which is filled with certain moral valuations, which have come to us, which is a very civilizational aspect, which comes to us through history, through memory, and it becomes then part of this collective subconscious. And these cultural codes, therefore, are floating around. For instance, the idea of ascetic, being ascetic, the way Prime Minister Modi retreated into caves after and meditating. Now, why did he take to that symbolism? He took to that symbolism because ascetism seems to be a deep social cultural value that we all believe in being anti-materialist, in being that materialism has to go along with certain morality, that you cannot have this unabashed modernist kind of idea of what capitalism does, that accumulation is a good thing, is a positive thing, but in our context materialism always goes with certain spirituality, a certain kind of a moral valuation, a certain kind of, there's a moral gaze which neoliberalism has dented, therefore there will be those tensions. Similarly, therefore we'll have to map what are these cultural codes that are floating around. So I just gave you one example of ascetism is one such cultural code. Therefore, if you closely read Mr. Modi's politics, his symbolism, what populists therefore are doing, especially the right-wing populists, is that they seem to understand these civilizational codes. Like I give you one example, ascetism seems to be a code. It's a code because it is something that cuts across politics, from RSS to the Maoists. They all believe in some form of ascetism. They all believe in moral purity. They all believe in simple living. They all believe in certain discomfort with the idea of pleasure. Therefore, some certain idea of the celibacy, brahmacharya, and so on and so forth. So I can go on about how there are these multiple cultural codes which are hidden. Which are not explicitly visible to us. No, we'll have to make sense of them as we go along. And right-wing populists in India are invoking those cultural codes. As we can see, his invocation of why this question that repeatedly keeps coming up: why, in spite of economy not doing well, does Modi's popularity not come down? How do they manage so much of conflict, all kinds of questions. So one way to understand them seems to be that populists therefore invest their politics through these existing cultural codes, that kind of a valuation, that kind of a morality. But these codes, by themselves they have this certain valuation. I mean, I think I'll maybe make it complex as they go along. So, I mean, if this is clear, we'll have to therefore understand that what comes to be hegemonic, what comes to be acceptable in certain political condition is how you occupy these cultural codes, how you negotiate your space with these cultural codes. Because our collective subconscious, we seem to be evaluating modern politics, evaluating social interactions through these cultural frames that are partly hidden, partly subconscious, we are not fully aware of them, so on and so forth. I give you one example of how ascetism works. Similarly, I can give you an example of how we are skeptical as a society about the modern idea of politics. That modern politics itself, we are skeptical. So this distinction we often seem to make between the social and the political. That there is something which is extra political. Pratama Banerjee in a recent book has done a fair interesting job of looking at this tension between the political and the non-political. That there seems to be something that we always invoke, whether it is Gandhi, whether it is Tagore, they invoke that politics contaminates something that is extra political. It could be spiritual, it could be the intimate, it could be something deeply personal, it could be sexual. There is therefore a space that is extra political. So that can so this is a binary we all we seem to our societies. So the social and political distinction. Now Gandhi also invoked it during anti-colonial movement. Between the social and the political. The political was reserved for anti-colonial, anti-British strategy, but the social was the domain where he was trying to negotiate the question of caste, gender, and class inequalities, which was not in terms of conflict. What is this distinction between the political and the social? In the political and the social, therefore, is a distinction broadly put would mean that the modern idea of the political is based on the idea of conflict. Social is based on the idea of solidarity. Of course, this is a binary that plays in all civilizations in different ways. I would recommend you to read cultural sociologist Jeffrey Alexander's work, where in his book on civil sphere, he makes this point that how all societies are based, societies are grounded in certain idea of solidarity, in certain idea of universal normativity. What that constitutes keeps shifting. But you need certain idea of solidarity of all social groups. You need certain idea of universal normativity. That there is a haunting heuristic universality that always exists within the domain of the social and the political. And that's the reason human beings legitimize their, even the worst of their most heinous of their strategies only through universal language. The best of the social demands and the worst of the social acts, there is always a certain validation through certain universal normativity. For instance, an unemployed youth. You'll never hear an unemployed youth say that I need a job. I must get a job. He or she would in fact argue that I need a job because everyone needs a job. There should be full employment. Everyone should be gainfully employed and therefore I need a job. Nobody can say that I need a job and others don't need jobs. So this does not happen. Even if in action, what the populists, right-wing populists do, even if they're excluding some very proactively, even that process of exclusion, even the process of use of violence, if you observe closely, comes in terms of invoking certain universality. That they are the ones who are actually... So these codes are malleable to multiple interpretations. So even if you look at the right wing's attack on secularism, they are not saying that we are non-secular, that we are against secularism. In fact, they are saying that we are secular, but and those who are claiming to be secular are actually pseudo-secular by in terms of appeasing the Muslims. And therefore, they are at the same time debunking secularism and appropriating secularism. So this is, I think, very distinct about right-wing strategy that they seem to debunk and appropriate simultaneously, partly because they seem to make sense of this underlying cultural codes, the way they're working. They're trying to occupy those spaces because they seem to understand that their agenda is all about being exclusionary, about hierarchical, it's conservative. It imposes, it uses violence, it is about self-interest. So they understand, they know that. But they know that in order to achieve this agenda, which is of a minor interest, which is in the interest of a minority caste Hindu, Brahminical dominant social groups. I have no doubts in saying that that is what the agenda finally is, including organizations like BJP and RSS. But it's not simply sufficient to keep saying this. As most of our secular progressive friends keep repeating ad nauseum, you know, they are Manusmriti, they are fascists, they are this, they are authoritarian, they are anti-Muslim. This doesn't work, you know, simply keep repeating because they are enforcing their agenda but not claiming, you know, no RSS guy will claim that, yes, I'm an authoritarian, or he wouldn't say I'm a fascist. He wouldn't say, yes, I believe in violence. Nobody would say that, yes, I will exclude all Muslims and all other religious minorities. Why would they not say it if they believe it? That's precisely the question that we need to ask. Even the worst bigot wouldn't state it what he believes, precisely because they realize that even the most exclusionary, most hierarchical, most violent of imaginations to gain political hegemony has to pass through the sieve of what I refer to as what Jeffrey Alexander actually refers to as the cultural codes. That is the cultural codes of a certain universality, of certain mutuality, of ideas of solidarity, of unity, so on and so forth. So that precisely is the reason why right-wing, in order to understand what authoritarian populism is doing in India today, is not simply sufficient to refer to them as authoritarian or refer to them as fascist. No, that doesn't cut much ice, because this idea of authoritarianism, this idea of violence, this idea of hierarchy, this idea of conservatism is gaining a hegemonic consensus. To whatever extent it has gained, one can keep differing how much of hegemony, how much it's electorally, it's only 38%. We can keep debating those things. But a hegemonic position, to whatever extent they have gained, was possible in spite of they having a such exclusionary, such limited, such hierarchical imagination that actually excludes the majority. They are in one sense castes, and therefore they exclude Dalits and Shudras. They are in terms of religious bigotry, they exclude Muslims, they exclude women. So they're actually not anti-minority, they're actually anti-majority. Yet they gain a certain hegemonic position. This should allow us to pause and think just how they're able to do this, not merely through intimidation, through use of force, through use of state machinery. RSS was never in power for 100 years. They're able to do this because they pass and sieve through their agenda through certain normative cultural codes that exist, through which people approach, perceive what they stand for through certain symbolic valuation, which is, as I said, in terms of these symbols of being pure, of being ascetic, of being honest. If you look at their slogan, who would have imagined a political party giving a slogan of Saaf Niyat, Sahi Vikas? Why is this idea of Saaf Niyat, the idea of intention, the idea of purity, how it flows? So all societies have this sacred, profane. So therefore, the idea of the sacred continues to exist. So Jeffrey Alexander, cultural sociologist, argues that modern societies continue to, the important thing that we need to understand is that modern societies are not transparent. In fact, modern societies are complex societies which interact through symbolic valuation, through symbols, and therefore the shared ethos are generated through this process of valuation. So the point I was making of Safnir, the way they invoke the idea of, therefore Jeff's point is that modern societies are not simply transparent. Modern societies are not simply scientific. Modern societies are not simply based on evidence. Now, these are the things that our own understanding of modernity has created. And therefore, he argues that modern societies continue to be structured socially through ideas of myth, story making, meaning, ideas of what is sacred, and so on and so forth. Therefore, all these ideas of myth, sacredness, continue to play an important role, because it is through these codes, we'll have to remember, through this symbolic valuation, that we make sense of life. It's a meaning-making exercise. And therefore, the current populists have sort of tabbed on all of this. I can go on elaborating as to what kinds of other cultural valuations they invoke. As I said, the distinction of social and political and so on and so forth. Idea of the ascetic, so on and so forth. Therefore, if this has made sense, how should one conceptualize, how should one then understand protest politics, protests in modern societies? When we know that meaning is not self-transparent in modern society, because modern societies are complex societies. Why are they complex? They're complex because there is a huge process of social differentiation. The social groups are differentiated along many, many axes: gender, caste, race, region, rural, urban, linguistic, ethnic, nationality, geography, social. So all these constitute social, what Charles Taylor called social imaginaries. Because of this multiple social locationalities. The multiplicity of social locationalities, modern societies are complex, and therefore communication and meaning is never transparent. You cannot have shade. What is meaning? Meaning is a consensus on what something means between you and me. So this very construction of shade meanings is itself a complex business in modern complex societies, because we all understand same processes, same symbols, same acts, same speech acts through our own locationality. So therefore, there's always multiple interpretations flowing. Therefore, interpretations always in meaning making is always a very tough struggle between multiple contested meanings. That's precisely the reason why there is so much of proliferation of importance of media, because media plays an important role in how you perceive a certain movement, how certain meaning is attached to certain acts, how certain symbolism can be read, so on and so forth. And populism, actually, it's an explosion of this symbolic valuation that underlies all politics. And but populism sort of very actively mobilizes this symbolic valuation. So if this is true, then one has to raise this question as to how do protest politics gain their rhetorical legitimacy in modern democracies. And that's where a recent piece that I attempted, a couple of pieces in The Wire and The Hindu, where I try to compare the anti-CAA movement with that of the farmers movement. And the question I tried to raise there was that why is it that a regime that we all, many of us, not all, many of us on the other side of the political divide feel is otherwise ruthless, it is run by a very hot-headed kind of strongman phenomena who doesn't budge to anything. There's only a man ki baat, one-way traffic. There's no dialogue, so on and so forth. Why is it that this regime, for the first time after it took over, was in one sense brought down to its knees of at least optics of continuous willingness to dialogue? Now, it went through 10 rounds, and we all know that these were more of optics than a genuine idea of dialogue. But they were compelled to say that we are in dialogue. We are consulting. They even said that the farm laws were made by consulting thousands of farmers' organizations before they were actually made. And then there is a tremendous hesitation in terms of dealing with farmers' movement through force or through violence. Even after yesterday's incident, there is this hesitation. That's one part of it. And the other part is that there is a continuous attempt to delegitimize the farmers' movement. So what are the dirty tricks of the government? What do they suggest? How are they attempting to kind of delegitimize the movement? By saying that this is not, at one level, they're arguing that this is not a farmers' movement, this is a movement of Khalistanis. So why farmers' movement becomes more acceptable but not of Khalistanis? This is what I was trying to argue, that this universal normative versus the sectarian. That once you depict a certain movement as being sectarian, as exclusive to certain groups, as self-interested, then its moral potency comes down. Its ability to gain legitimacy is eroded. So you'll have to closely observe this tussle, that eventually the point is this regime will be able to use force. That is not based on numbers. They are Sikhs, they have horses, they are, can also be militant. This kind of popular commonsensical talk is going on, but that's not the issue. The issue is not just because they are Sikhs and they can militant and things like that, that the government is hesitant to use force. They're hesitant to use force because force and violence can be used only after the moral hegemonic devaluation of a movement happens. And that has to happen in popular imagination. And therefore, what the government is doing is precisely this. They are now in the business of devaluing the movement. So yesterday's incident was, it looks, today's Hindu's front page carried that it was a conspiracy of the government. What was the conspiracy of the government? The conspiracy of the government is to show a movement that is non-violent and collective as something that is violent and hooligan. A movement that is based on farmers who are talking about more universal values of food security as a movement that belongs only to rich farmers. A movement that, on one hand, we are saying includes movements of farmers from different parts of India, is being depicted as only farmers' movement that belongs to Haryana and Punjab. Or a movement that we are, on one hand, we are told includes CAPS, left unions, women, even Dalit, daily wage laborers who work, is being depicted as a movement that only belongs to the Jats. So if you see these, what is this tussle all about? Why is it that the movement is claiming something, the government is claiming something else? What is the tussle all about? The tussle is precisely this. What is its potential to occupy those cultural codes of solidarity? That is this movement in the self-interest or in the larger universal normative interest? Or is it a very sectarian interest talking about only its personal interests? So it is quite obvious that even if it were to be in this interest, that issue is not what it is. The issue is how, what kind of a language, what kind of a universal discourse does the movement take recourse to. And that's where I think the farmers' movement did pretty well in terms of occupying and projecting a certain universal normativity. That they said that this is about the food security of India. This is about the model of development. This is about including. So what happens eventually, the point is this, what happens eventually is that once you project it through these kinds of normative cultural framing, most people with the different social location, as I said, in their differentiated through their social differentiation, are able to represent themselves in that farmers' movement. So once you say food security, it matters to everyone. Yes, I mean, you know, tomorrow if corporates manage the entire food, all of us become vulnerable. This is something akin to the kind of symbolism that Gandhi used during the anti-colonial movement. Why did Gandhi invoke the symbolism of salt? It's because salt is something that is used cutting across classes and castes. Everyone uses salt, is an inevitable indispensable ingredient in everyone's food. And therefore, once he said salt satyagraha, and he said the right to use salt without being taxed, it immediately rings a bell between your everyday food habit and the idea of sovereignty. I mean, it's a stroke of genius on the part of Gandhi to be able to link this abstract idea of sovereignty or Swaraj with the concept of everyday food habits. Now, that's the reason salt was such a potentially such an explosive symbolism that everybody could relate to it. You didn't have to then mobilize from a farmer to a landless laborer to everybody gets mobilized around that. So every movement at any given point in time will have to generate this potential normativity of this kind of around ideas of solidarity to gain this kind of an acceptance which makes it difficult for the state to sort of use violence. And if it does, suppose you gain this kind of a moral valuation, in spite of that state uses force, which is possible, then the state's use of violence stands delegitimized. It gets more and more interrogated. There is less and less consent for that kind of violence. You can imagine that the current regime did something very similar to an institution like JNU, that they could have done the crackdown that they did against JNU students the first day they took over power. They have all the force with them, and we are just a small university of few thousand. But no, it waited. Why? It first did a round of delegitimization, all this tukde, anti-national, this, that, and the other. And then it went on to crack down. So all that discourse, it is fake, and it is based on, of course, false allegations, false narrative. Of course, they have the media power, all of that. But what is important for us to understand in terms of mobilizing, counter-mobilization, is the potency of that kind of a discourse that is often invoked. In that context, I argued that this contrast, the farmers' movement perhaps had this edge of invoking a social identity with a more universal normativity, with a larger idea of solidarity, where different social groups could sort of read their story alongside that of the story of the farmers. In comparison to that, there's no denying that CA and NRC is an unjust law, it is state, and all of that one can go on and on about it. But the point is, if you are to mobilize a movement against CAA, in spite of the fact that it exclusively targets only the Muslims, the success of anti-CAA movement exists in how it throws up this idea of solidarity, how it's able to convince the majority that this anti-CA is against interests of most people, and why, in what sense it is unethical. And that's where I've argued that perhaps the anti-CA movement has not put as much emphasis as it should have on producing this universality. Of course, it has, as I pointed out in my recent pieces, that it has a complex, therefore one has to be in generating these mobilizations, you'll have to understand the locationality. This locationality of why we have to raise this very awkward and difficult question, that why such blatant violence against Muslims gains this kind of either an active consent or at best active content, at worst indifference. It is not given. It is not that I have just read a couple of rejoinders to my piece. I mean, I would only say these are poor rejoinders, which actually miss the point. Look, immediately post partition, there was no violence against Muslims. Post Ayodhya, post Babri Masjid, BJP lost power in Uttar Pradesh. So this prejudice against Muslims, this sanction for mob lynching, this impunity against explicit violence against Muslims has been constructed over a period of time. And that construction has happened by consistently depicting Muslims to be exclusionary and sectarian, monolithic, self-enclosed, self-ghettoized kind of a community. And that's where the sanction for the violence comes from. That's where the indifference of the dominant majority Hindu community comes from. Apart from there, many other, therefore there is a sense of history for this. Why one can very validly raise this question, why should this be so? This is so because there is a certain history to Hindu-Muslim relations in India. There is a history of bloody partition and violence happened from both ends. And Muslims were rulers at one point of time. Entire medieval history is about Islamic rule. And therefore, all this, as I pointed out, this, Islam is a global community. It is not national. They are big in numbers. Even in India, they are of sizable numbers, which leads to this kind of a vulnerability of demographic threats. It is tipped to be the fastest growing religion, while Hinduism exists only in one country, one nation. The Hindus self-represent themselves as being vulnerable, so on and so forth. I mean, one can go on about various historical, sociological factors, the way therefore, as I said, all these facts of history, quote unquote facts of history, are made into a narrative, are invoked, what Laclau calls, they're stitched. The suttering happens, that they are all stitched in such a way that it produces a certain narrative. And all this needs to be taken in popular imagination seriously. And it is not about mere facts. It is not, I mean, this is a point that, I mean, I have in vain been arguing with our progressive left secular friends. It's not merely about producing alternate facts. It's not merely saying that Muslims cannot reproduce at the pace to overthrow Hindu population. It is about generating a certain kind of a narrative that is relatively projects Muslims as more affable, more amiable. More amicable. And that is when I think the hegemonic potential of creating either sanction or indifference towards Muslims can be arrested. Here, I think it produces very complex dynamics about what is the place for Muslim identity itself. I don't have the time. I've almost run out of that. I've overshot. Actually, if I had time, I would have gone into that question of representation. But I don't think I'll get into that because that needs an elaborate explanation. But suffice it to say that, therefore, that all protests have to claim to represent themselves through this composite culture. It is not merely sufficient to say that Muslims are composite. You know, I would assert my identity. I would fight it as a Muslim. Things of this kind. You can do that. Provided those social conditions, those codes, or cultural codes as they're arranged, allow you to do that. Where the hegemonic sanction for violence becomes difficult. Without doing that, if you simply make these claims, I think which makes it both ahistorical and also a poor sociology of understanding politics and power. I think I'll stop here, Manisha, and maybe we can throw it open for discussion.
Thank you, Ajay. Wonderful and very, very rich and very textured presentation that you have made, covering social codes, cultural codes, weaving popular imaginaries into cultural codes. And how collective subconsciousness works on these social codes, and how the protest movements, both the farmers and the anti-CA movement, have basically differ from each other on the way in which they have used these social codes. So wonderful. I think there are lots of questions on the chat box. Would you like me to read out those questions to you, or how do you think would it be convenient? How do you want me to go about it?
either way, I mean, there are two, oh my God, there are a lot of them, but I don't know.
Yes.
What should we do? I mean, should we, it will take a lot of time.
I think you know, some of these questions, I let me just broadly put them together. You know, one strand of question relates to the farmers' protest movement post the 26th January event, and how is it going to work in the popular imagination, because the moral high ground that the farmers seem to be enjoying is dented in some ways. Similar to that is another question, and Shweta Dahiya asks whether why is this regime, you know, necessarily considered as fascist, violent, manipulative, like that? I mean, what happened in JNU? Was it not an expression of separatism? So it's working on a, what she means to say probably is they're working on a parallel collective consciousness, an alternative political consciousness. So how does one, you know, reconcile that? There is also another strand of question which relates to India and USA. Taha raises this question. She says, you see populism both in USA and India and many other countries of the world for that matter. But why is it that it has worked in favor of Modi second time around and has not worked with Trump? You know, that how is it that Trump failed in interpreting, you know, the collective consciousness? You know, that and there's also another question which leads, you know, which is something that I also began, that is it indicative of breakdown of a social contract kind of protests? Which says rights and duties are to be reconciled. So how can that kind of reconciliation happen in an atmosphere of violence on the side of the government and, you know, protest politics on the other hand? So these are broadly, I mean, there's also one more question, and here, how the question, how majority will defend themselves from these manipulative universal paraphrases? Okay, because the government is authorized to use violence. So again, mainly the question relating to construction of alternative narratives, and to all these questions, I would want to add mine, which is how, you know, the populism is not something new. You know, this variety of populism probably is new, but populism in Indian politics is pretty old. And when we start to generalize, how do we distinguish one brand of populism from another brand of populism and attach certain moral codes to it? I mean, and justify those moral codes. After all, if populism is built on breaking down the barrier between the public and the private and builds on institution, then liberalism has also sort of failed in and has undermined, you know, especially in a country like India, where public-private dialogue, as Ashish Nandi would say, enriched the public life in a great way. So under those circumstances, how do you see, you know, the construction of collective identities?
Yeah. So thanks, Manisha. Thanks for that. I hope you've covered. I mean, if anyone else, they can also directly kind of ask what is the major riots happened during BJP or NDA regime. Okay. Okay, let me begin with that first interesting question that should matter to us, Dr. Noh. What to the farmers' movement after 26 January? So this is really clearly the case that, you know, that the government definitely as we see, some of us are able to see through, is building a case to delegitimize farmers movement, is to definitely use violence against farmers, as I see it. But they have to prepare a case for it. They have all the force at hand to do that willfully. But they have to do that only after they are sure that there is a more there is a larger popular consent, and that comes, as I said, by how we are interpreting, how we frame the farmers' protest. So you can already see the difference in the way of, in popular imagination, in popular consciousness, how there's a shifting valuation of the farmers that has happened. That before January 26, we had a certain unified imagination of the farmers as non-violence, as they were being terribly disciplined. They are fighting for certain food security, their intentions being pretty transparent, so on and so forth. And then you had the post 26. The government is continuously trying. They tried this even before, right? They said there are Khalistanis, there are terrorists, there are rich farmers, there are all of that. So what this should allow, this should, I think, force us to pause and think that why did that not stick? It's the same government with the same resources, with the same hold on media. These are the same farmers. They are the Sikhs. They are
can I interrupt you for a minute? I mean, because there is also a popular belief that these are not really farmers. These are not, you know, in the popular imagination, these are rich farmers who are fighting. They are, in that sense, the capitalist class of a different variety. And that also, I think you need to address that segment.
That's true, precisely. So that is sociologically true. And I think the farmers, so this is the case, that they are rich farmers now. Now, how do we, so it is not, the moral valuation of the idea of rich farmers is not self-evident, right? It has to seep through an interpretative frame. That how do we, so one frame is to say that these are very rich farmers, self-seeking class, NRIs, their children are studying in Canada and United States, why the hell they need these subsidies. So if you're on Facebook, many of them sympathetic to Mr. Modi would interpret it this way, which is not factually untrue, that the farmers themselves are claiming that they are well-off sections, we have been able to mobilize precisely because we are well-off. But if the idea had stopped with simply being rich farmers, I think this story of the farmers' movement would have been over long back. But what have they done is that if they are talking, it is about food security of India, which is as much of a truth as the fact that these are rich farmers. This is about agrarian sector as such. It is not about our own interest, because it only if agriculture does well. So why did the Dalit landless wage laborers from Punjab join this protest movement? Because they have a class conflict with rich farmers. And they made a very simple point that if the farming sector itself gets, if the agrarian sector itself gets into crisis, then how are we going to benefit even as wage laborers, even if the rich farmers are to lose out? So see, look, these are the narratives which have convinced the popular imagination that, look, there is something very grave about this farmers' issue, that it is about the food security of the nation. You cannot simply give away the food security of nation to two corporate houses. If Ambani and Adani are to take over through building huge warehouses, the entire food security of the nation, they might tomorrow trade them away. So look, even with the corporate private sector, in one framing, you can there's a positive valuation of them as a growth, some are harbingers of growth, they create new employment, they're taking India to the next level, which is the rhetoric Modi plays on. But there's also another narrative that these are the corporates who are unethical, who are private profit seekers who basically work for themselves, and the development and all that humbug is only by default. Therefore, you cannot trust Mr. Ambani and Adani to simply give away or put security. And Ambani was forced to give a statement, issue a statement saying that I have no interest in the food sector, I have never made any investment, so on. But these are very important markers for us how the farmers' movement succeeded in occupying that normative valuation in such a way that even powerful state corporate players had to kind of negotiate. Therefore, post 26, the continued attempt of this government, especially under Mr. Amit Shah, will be this: to delegitimize them, to reproject them as hoodlums, as terrorists, as lumpens, as self-seeking, and all of that. You know, and much of this is conspiracy. That these are planted stories, these are planted conspiracies. As farmers said yesterday, that the routes that were allowed for the farmers to, where permission was granted, were the routes that were blocked so that farmers dispersed, and all of that which has come out in the media. So what is that the government is doing? This is a question that we should pause and ask. Why is it that the government is not cracking down? After all, it's few lakhs, and Indian army is way too powerful with their paramilitary forces which can crack down on the farmers and disperse them. It's not a big deal. It cannot, simply because there is a certain valuation that's happening. But that possibility, I might dare say, exists with the Muslims of this country, that there can be an en masse disenfranchisement, there can be en masse genocidal violence. I mean, this is a clear possibility under this regime when it comes to Muslims. And this this case of championing the rights of the Muslims cannot be won merely by declaring this as fascist, authoritarian, they're communal, all of that. I mean, we'll gradually, if we do not get our narrative right, it will almost come to that question of why. The other day I was teaching in my class, a student asked me, what is wrong in being communal? Why should I, is there any compulsion that I should like Muslims? You know, what is wrong if I don't like Muslims? This was a question that I confronted in the class, which made me pause and think that yes, this is this could be a valid question. This can be anyway addressed in different ways. But the question is this: therefore, there is a valuation. Therefore, Muslims have been projected, interpreted, valued in a certain mode in popular consciousness, and right is doing it in a relentless way. So one can simply call it prejudice, false news, fake news, propaganda. You can keep harping on it. As Jeffrey says, that you cannot counter a narrative of valuation through facts and figures and evidence and scientificity. This is where we'll have to get our story. And you might produce a fact that Muslims, whatever pace they might reproduce, cannot overtake 80% Hindu population. It's a fact. Muslims, whatever they might do, given their position on the social indicators, can never stand back on their feet to become rulers of this country. This is not how popular consciousness works. I mean, those who argue like this, I mean, simply don't understand how sociology of politics works. To just lighten up things, I should share a joke that Amrik Singh once narrated how Hindus think of Muslims. He told me this joke that once a Hindu was sitting on the back of a Muslim and thrashing him up. But the Hindu was crying. He was crying and beating up the Muslim. So a passerby, I believe, asked, "Arey bhai, tum uske peeth pe baithe ho, tum usko maar rahe ho, tum kyun ro rahe ho?" And the Hindu says, "Ab ye utke mujhe bahut peetega." So the question is this: this anxiety is an intangible anxiety. The Hindu anxiety is an intangible anxiety, that it has been constructed through certain question of framing. So if you say that there is no need for Hindu to be anxious because you are 80%, because you are all of that, a Hindu can produce back a narrative by saying that we might be majority in this country, but Muslims are a majority globally. You might say that you are economically powerful, but a Hindu might turn back and say that there are Muslims in the Middle East who are much more powerful, they are much closer, so on and so forth. this anxiety is a constructed anxiety through certain codes. This has to be made sense of. Simply rattling of unstructured evidence, however true that might be. We have to make this distinction between fact and truth. Truth is comes out of a narrative. You'll have to establish it as a truth. That's why, did Foucault say truth is power? Why did he say truth regimes? Why do regimes use the idea of truth? It's not because there is no truth. That's not what Foucault meant. The Foucauldian idea of critique of truth is precisely that truth includes this interpretative exercise, and once it gains that hegemony, it excludes all those others who fall out of the net of that truth regime. So we will have to establish, we'll have to see through, and that has to be a very delicate, intricate business of history, sociology, imagination, psychology. It cannot be simply a kind of an outburst claims, and I had said that as when I am attacked as a Jew, I will respond back as a Jew. So if I am attacked and critiqued as a Muslim, I will hit back as a Muslim, which is good enough if that's working for you to create the larger notions of sympathy and compassion among a majority audience. Good luck to you. But the question is, if they don't, I mean, the analysis usually, when it doesn't, then they say it's all prejudice. I mean, yes, these are the factors of complex modern societies. That where does recognition end and where does prejudice begin is a very difficult thing for us to demarcate. These are not readily available demarcations for us, that when is a Muslim claiming a legitimate recognition and representation, when is he actually sectarian? It's again a very complex, so it's open to interpretation. Therefore, we have to take that larger net of social differentiation, that when you're communicating, that your symbolism, that valuations you're offering need to speak to people in different social locations. Now, only then is there a chance for hegemony. What Hindutva is doing, I mean, it's a clear example of how Hindutva, which is belongs to a minuscule kind of caste Hindu, yes, socially and economically powerful groups, yet created a narrative. Why is it that RSS took 100 years? It took 100 years precisely because it is today able to create a narrative that is speaking to different social sections. From Lingayats, who came as a kind of rebellion against Brahminical Hinduism, today are the social base of BJP in Karnataka. Dalits today are sympathetic to agenda of being Hindus. OBCs and lower end OBCs today see themselves as Hindus. So this is a narrative. There's no point simply saying this is all manufactured. Hinduism has been manufactured. There's nothing like, I mean, I just saw in Caravan an article which says that Hinduism is never existed, it's 19th century. Everything in modern societies is complexly manufactured. Nothing is socially naturally available. We all are manufacturing identities. We are all manufactured projects. So in that sense, so there's no point in going to this kind of a rhetoric. Therefore, there's no Hindu identity. No, it is succeeding. And we'll have to see that it's succeeding because the story that is being told by the Hindu right is a story that multiple social groups in differentiated social locations are able to see their interests and their self-image represented in it. And therefore, a movement like anti-CA movement has to compulsively generate a kind of a dynamics which I think everyone else, you know, if you see even the anti-CA movement, the first part of the anti-CA movement had a much larger Hindu participation than it did previously. And the later part, it became more and more exclusively Muslim protest, and that's my problem. But I said that they did the right thing by, why did they push women onto the streets? Why did women, Muslim women protest? Why not Muslim men? That is valuation. That you want to show the intensity, integrity of this movement when Muslim women who are otherwise in the private domain have come to the public. It is a certain kind of a valuation you are indicating. Like, look, we are serious about it. There is a sense of serious vulnerability, because majority social Hindu groups don't even feel that Muslims are really under threat of any kind. Therefore, these guys are way too powerful to be under threat. You know, when I talk to my classmates, I learn all this from them, that they say, kaha ka baat kar rahe ho tum? I mean, they don't even believe, you know, those groups don't even believe that Muslims can be genuinely under threat, because they feel these are really powerful groups who have been ruling elites, who are globally powerful. They can never be so vulnerable as some of us feel anxious that, you know, this, where is this country heading? So you'll have to get that valuation right to push groups like this to really think, and how do you do it? And that's where I think a complex business of coding comes into place. And to Manisha's question as to what is the difference, yes, all democracies, I think, have a populist tinge, because, as I said, populism is a mode of doing politics, is a kind of moral valuation of politics, and there can be no democratic representative politics without this kind of evaluation. But there are distinctions. So even Mrs. Gandhi's phase, you had this idea of Durga when she did Bangladesh war. Even Vajpayee had to invoke the idea of being Durga, and so on and so forth. But there are minute differences, sociological, political, economy differences that have come about. For instance, earlier it was more in terms of patron-client relations that the symbolism worked. Today it's more in terms of aspirational, post-patron-client kind of breakdown of patronage networks. You want a more dialogic, more voluntary. So I can point out the number of differences. But the larger question, which is again a very difficult question, is the interface or link between political economy and cultural sociology of populism. This is something that I'm working on currently, that why did populism and cultural majoritarianism succeed in India after neoliberal reforms? Is it a chance, happenstance element? Is it just an element of contingency, or is there something more structural? I think this is a very complex question as to how neoliberalism, hard materialism, lays out certain social conditions for certain kind of populism to become more effective. So political economy provides a context, but may not directly determine populist trends. And therefore, populism has this additional dimensions of morality, symbolism, valuation, so on, personality, psychology, and how those interactions happen. Sometimes they succeed, sometimes they don't, sometimes they fit in, sometimes they don't fit in. I think this is something for us to analyze every day, almost it's an every day. So that's the reason, Manisha, why I'm forced to write every day. Because every day you'll have to see how there sometimes is a fit between neoliberalism and majoritarianism. Sometimes you see there's absolutely no fit. The majoritarianism works on its own kind of projected truth, which works sometimes contrary to the neoliberal interests. Look at what is happening to Indian economy, that more and more majorities are pushing, the economy is going on downward trend, precisely because investments are running away. This kind of atmosphere is simply not helping economy. So you have a new challenge suddenly, the downward economy. What kind of a turn will majoritarianism take in this? They began with a fit between development and majoritarianism. Today, they're actually completely in contrast to each other. So what options are left with the current regime when this new turn has taken place? And it looks very clear to me that they are very reckless about economy. They don't seem to be interested in reviving it. They seem to be thinking that the more desperate people become, the more majoritarian they would become. Are they right in their reading? May not be. I mean, one has to closely observe this to see how people respond. This beyond common sense ideas that if people are desperate, then they become more religious, or they become psychopaths. May not be. Desperation leads to people to fascism. Desperation leads to people to spirituality also. So which of the two people will take turn to is something that one has to only closely observe before commenting.
Okay, there are more questions that have come up, Ajay. Maybe there's one very interesting question by Soumya. Soumya, would you like to ask that question?
Yeah, why don't you ask instead of briefly?
Good afternoon, sir.
Yeah, We can hear you.
Yeah. So I was just asking, you said for the protests to have scope of success and stand up to state, they have to control their narrative through a normative cultural frame. You know, so like for CA protest, to have control over their narratives, they have to, what are you suggesting? Because their identity itself is demonized by the state as well as the West. I mean, Islamophobia is not contextual. It's not of India. It's a global phenomena. And if they're living with their identity and their identity markers of their clothes and everything, so it's an act of resistance in itself, right? So, like, what do you suggest that how do they have control over their narrative when their identity itself is demonized?
Let me pose a counter question. What do you mean by resistance? What is resistance? Is to claim that we are. Is that resistance?
What came into my mind was like the secular Muslims as well of India. So we take Umar Khalid. He has this Gandhian ideas of protest and resistance and everything, but he's still behind the bars. So is Shahjil Imam, whose ideologies won't ever be acceptable to the state. So it's actually the identity that they're after, right? So how does the CA movement have a control over their narrative when the identity is demonized?
So that's precisely the question. So if you are saying that even somebody who is claiming a secular identity larger, Umar Khalid can be behind prison, do you think somebody simply claiming, I am Muslim, I will be a Muslim, is going to lead to more resistance? Is that how Muslims are going to come out of this perceptible threat, possible genocide in India? So these are, the point is this, that normativity is a complex thing of universal normativity has to be stitched to existing historical sociological conditions. You simply cannot claim whatever you wish, you know, and then think that this is going to work out. I mean, good luck. If you think that, one should experiment. But point is to be open, that, you know, if you have set narrative. Look, Jeffrey Alexander makes a very interesting case. You should all read, those of you who are interested in anti-CA and deeply concerned about the Muslim question. He begins with the civil rights movement in the United States. And he said, why did the civil rights movement succeed in bringing about changes and providing the kind of mobility it did for the blacks? It did precisely because the civil rights movement facing slavery in the South of America began to speak to the white Americans in the North, which was more advanced capitalist, and South was more agrarian and slave-based. And he says that when whites were increasingly getting convinced that, you know, this kind of a slavery is not going to work, that's when a solidarity starts enlarging. That's when, you know, you try to create more universal registers of normativity. And then that's when Martin Luther King began to make a much larger impact. So it is about creating these networks. As Foucault said, world is never going to be a perfect wonderland for any one of us to live by. You know, the power flows that way. So the power exists with social groups. Power is always differentiated. There is no equilibrium. What we can do if we take this as given is that in any given context, how do you enlarge that narrative? How do you enlarge the appeal of the narrative in creating these markers, these interpretative markers, which makes it difficult? It is not that even after that regime is not going to do. So somebody as innocuous and as dialogic and as friendly, I know Umar Khalid personally, as friendly, open-ended. Look at Stan Swamy, forget Umar Khalid. Stan Swamy, 80 years old, father, did social service all his life. State can still clamp you down, but that kind of irrational clamping down will open up its own spaces. That's where this regime is continuously also, it delegitimizes itself by doing all these erratic things, what Yogi Adityanath does in his irrational mode, creating encounters, random killings, you know, blaming those who are protesting against riots, you know, booking Harsh Mandir. These things will have their own consequences. One has to, in a democracy, by definition, means popular consent. Why did democracy think popular consent? Because we believe that in a democratic participation, a reasonable, moderate consensus is possible, that people will turn around to see the big picture. But it's the responsibility of the protest movements to project that big picture. It is not sufficient to say, I am a Muslim, I will be a Muslim, I will project, I will protest, come what may. You can always do that, but there are consequences. If you get ghettoized, if majority society does not, as it's happening, as I see, there's an increasing, I can see in my own relations from 20 years back to now, the massive indifference that has spread towards Muslims is humongous. I mean, an 8-year-old kid gets gang raped in Jammu, this Asipas case. I mean, should reveal something, and majority community does not respond. I mean, this community constitutes people like you and me, you know, the people who have regular lives, who have kids, who have families, who are religious, who are spiritual. It should pause and ask us, why is it that these guys, as I said, at worst is indifferent, and at best is an active consent to even an 8-year-old kid being gang raped, and they feel either they feel it has not happened, or they feel it's a conspiracy, or they feel, some of them even feel it's okay. It happens because your frames of moral valuation have been contaminated and corrupted in certain ways, you know, because of the way the right-wing symbolism, it penetrates into your, so therefore, you know, psychoanalyst Sudhir Kakkar says that during riots in Gujarat, milk was contaminated. Of course, a lot of conspiracy, RSS indulges in a lot of conspiracy. So it's important for us to sort of acknowledge and, you know, reveal these conspiracies as much as get the valuation of what they do. Why did these groups contaminate milk that was being spread through right wing, and then they said that this milk has been contaminated by the Muslims? It's precise. He says that milk is associated with the maternal security. That's a very primordial kind of security we all feel with mother. The early psychoanalysts lay a lot of emphasis on this maternal initial attachment to milk and breastfeeding, so on and so forth. He said, therefore, there was a deep biopolitical, psychoanalytical value to the way why they contaminated milk that comes to you, which, because something, mother's milk is something you are very unsuspecting of. It's a basic faith that constitutes us. Once you pollute that, then you become extremely doubtful of everything. Then you have the psychopathic tendencies. Then you become indifferent to violence. So they have to see through these things. So they are able to understand, which our secular, progressive left friends in their general indifference don't seem to make sense. You know, simply by asserting being Muslim, and if you keep just, you know, shouting on top of the roof 100 times and saying that we need secularism, we need constitutionalism, it's not going to work. It has to, we'll have to understand how they are able to break these barricades, how they are able to build these notions. That is because they're building alternative interpretative frames, and we'll have to reoccupy them. We'll have to break their nets of interpretation and reoccupy them and create a certain images of Muslim. And that has to be done. You know, recently I saw Muslims farmer being part of the farm protest. So we'll have to do, mostly, for instance, Muslims have to hold, the basics have held longers. You know, that image of that masculine Muslim, of an invader, of somebody who is extremely powerful, who is being a ruling elite, all these are part of popular consciousness, partly true, partly factually true. One cannot deny that there have been Muslim excesses in the past, in the medieval history. Of course, our historians can make a very subtle, nuanced analysis that these were not religious, but these were through medieval. But in popular consciousness, they get filtered out and received as something that they have. Other castes or other religions cannot be depicted similarly as Muslims. So there is a specificity. Therefore, I am very critical. Again, I have written, and there have been a lot of critical pieces where I argue that there is no Islamophobia in India. that simply by calling everything Islamophobia, I think it's a complete and empty rubbish. You know, everything you say is Islamophobia, medieval history, Islamophobia. I don't think this is a very upstart, and this actually is a counterproductive. That hatred and that violence, consent for violence and Muslims is being contextually generated from multiple discourses of gender, sexuality, sexual aggression, masculine construct of Muslim men, certain construct of history, certain construct of, as I said, multiple. I mean, if you go to Uttar Pradesh, still Muslims in certain parts are landed and they indulge in as much of exploitation of Dalits. If you go and interview, I've done this. Dalits interviews of Dalits daily wages, they say that Muslims are as exploited. That's a class exploitation, but it will be depicted as religious. So point is, there are contextually the many multiple reasons why this conflict is being projected and why it is getting to be accepted. If we don't dig into all of those and offer a very lazy counter narrative, sab kuch Islamophobia hai, I don't think, I mean, some of them are even referring to my writings as Islamophobia. I don't think this kind of a blanket, any interrogation being referred to as everything as Islamophobic, that's only, we are only shedding any deliberation, and that actually helps in reprojecting. Just imagine if you shed all debate on Muslim questions, it actually helps in reprojecting them as some kind of a ghettoized, you know, a unified, homogeneous, something undercover, nobody can touch them. And that even scares me. That, you know, here is something like a dark ghost in a dark room, that you can't touch anything, you can't raise gender question, then you become a non-secular, you can't raise Muslim masculinity question, then you become Islamophobic, you can't raise any issues. This only helps in generating in a popular imagery of a community that is beyond question, and then that gets feeds into the idea of appeasement, and then that leads to a consent for violence. So I think we'll have to open up. We might go wrong sometimes. We might get certain things right. But by blanket, this kind of an anxiety prone, that's why I say that much of the protest happens, is framed through the majoritarian gaze itself. It's not outside. The majoritarian gaze is inbuilt in the way you're assuming the protest.
Yeah. Shweta, you had multiple questions. Would you want to raise one of them, maybe related to I think this would be the last question. Ajay is also quite visibly tired. So, Shweta, do you want to raise something?
Yes, ma'am. Probably the last one only, since now the context is there only. I mean, in the view of this anti-CAA movement which was going on, and as you also mentioned, that women were at the forefront. So, I mean, it would have gained more legitimacy, don't you think? So, if the women have always been coming out in support of their own rights in the period of even recent history, like whether what comes to my mind is that Shah Bano case. Ultimately, what happened was, like, she was outcast and she had to withdraw her stand, or in favor of like triple talaq, or even coming into the ambit of universal civil court, so that you are coming into the bigger ambit of, you know, being equal. So somewhere denying all this is not taking away the legitimacy. How do you perceive this?
Your voice was not clear. So you're asking about the question of Muslim women, right, Manisha? She's saying
Muslim women
coming out in open.
Yeah. This is the last question in the chat box also, if you want to.
So that precisely, the precise point I noted in my piece, that why did the Muslims feel the need? These are the questions that one should pause. Why did anti-CAA movement not be led by men? Why did they bring out their families? Why were their kids? Why were there Muslim women? Why were there old Muslim women sitting in the court? It is because in complex societies, as I said, that you can, meaning is not self-evident. Intention is not self-evident. So by bringing old women, by bringing women, you communicate a certain non-conflictual, non-masculine, non-exclusive kind of a dynamic, to say that this is also about our families, this is also about our kids, this is also about our future. Even after that, you may not, but the majority Hindu community may not get convinced of your purity. Therefore, but that was a very good strategy. You know, that did dent a lot in the way this regime dealt with it. It could not immediately crack down. Why did this regime tolerate Shaheen Bagh for so long? It did try to use it, but it didn't work in Delhi election. Why? Using violence on women, using violence against children becomes all that more difficult. Now that there is a certain valuation that we have in popular consciousness, and therefore you cannot simply go and crack down on all women and say, I mean, there were attempts even to molest some of them. But
Ajay, what she is wanting to ask you is that Muslims have rather been ghettoized, rather than being part of a major, but for the CAA, but for the CAA, and therefore even during CAA when they come out in protest, there is still an element of doubt, and therefore their legitimacy is questionable.
Yeah, one of the questions that Muslims raise as a counter to this is that society has ghettoized us. For instance, they don't get housing when they come to any Hindu colony in Delhi, and then you blame us being ghettoized. So these dynamics operate, but the point is this: the point is how do Muslims project themselves beyond that ghettoization? That, yes. Therefore, I always argue that Muslims cannot overcome this projected, whether it's real or projected, whatever it might be. We can all keep debating on multiple facts. As long as they speak about issues of exclusive identity and only about themselves, Muslims will have to talk about rights of tribals, about Dalits. They'll have to be part of other social demands like universal education, full employment. They have to be part of demands for federal setups. They have to be part of demands for federal rights. Why is that we don't see Muslims in all these protests? Right? So is it only the concern of the Hindu majority? One can even pose the question the other way around to raise all the questions of democracy, and Muslims reserve their protest only for Muslim-related issues. This is not good. Why is that Mr. Owaisi now, who is become the new face of Muslim Voice, is found only on the show Babri Masjid? Is it not the responsibility of Mr. Owaisi to demand full employment and full free and fair education for all, which includes Muslims? But Owaisi will never raise those social demands because his politics is inbuilt in that majoritarian gaze of only identitarian, exclusive identitarian question. Again, I have written series of critical write-ups on Owaisi, and again we had had response from our Muslim friend saying that he's our only leader and he has come after a long time, and even you are critical of that space. No, it's not about that space or this space. How are those optics going to work out? So we will have to have Muslims, I think, come out, not only Muslim women just come out, but I think come out for demands, of a range of demands, which is what I think is going to nullify this kind of an anxiety that has been created among Hindu majority. So there are many more. I've explained my writings. You can go over them. Any of these Muslim friends, girls, would have wanted to question?
Zainab is there.
Any one of you, just feel free. If you completely disagree with me and you think what I said doesn't make sense, you can freely ask me. There's no issues about that. Feel free. If you are angry with me, you can go ahead and shoot a sharp question.
You have to raise difficult questions. You have to introspect, yes. and there can be no better time to introspect than now.
Yes, absolutely.
I want to raise this question.
Taha seems to have left.
No, she's there.
Is it should I raise my question about USA?
You talk about what you think about the Muslim identity.
Yeah, Muslim, what I have to say on the Muslim identity and anti-CAA.
It's very, like you said, it's very multifaceted, but thing is that what adding on to what Soumya said, what I was thinking that, like sir said, that what one cannot just be all out about their, like, this very masculine, very image that people have about the Muslim community. We cannot just reimpose that and expect people to not have that sort of image. But then again, when it comes to identity, there will always be some sort of preconceived notion when these tangents are being discussed. Daily, like you discussed about Yogi Adityanath, like I am someone from UP, and I can see the sort of hostile environment that is here regarding Muslims, and it just keeps gaining ground because of we have a chief minister who's not that sort of accepting about minorities here. So we don't really have a choice to completely, like, what can we say, neutralize our identity either. We'll always stand out like a sore spot. So I don't understand that what could be the middle ground, like not even being, like, it's very, you could say we are also having a crisis because we don't really want to be a sore spot either, but we don't want to hide either. So it's confusing.
That's
Yeah,
that's
and I
true.
think
That's
Zainab also had the similar kind of question.
Zainab, yes, Zainab, please go
Zainab?
on. Go ahead. I saw Zainab left, I think.
Okay, she
There
had
is
the
another
question,
Zainab.
how can 20% of the Muslims be a threat to 80% of the Hindus? I mean, that's
Is
a
there
question
a
she's trying
question?
to raise. No, she's there. Zainab? Okay, I think
You can, I can take the last question. Yes, I think you put your spot on in saying that that's the conclusion we are all going through. I think Muslims have been pushed to the corner to, you know, this OIC. I can realize it when I've when I'm critical of OIC becoming the representative of Muslim politics. I mean, it's a valid point. Many of them ask that, you know, we have almost become invisible, representation has declined, and now you have a leader, and then so you don't wish to be invisible. I mean, there has to be a dignified presence of Muslims as Muslims in a democracy, which I think is a fair point of recognition, and that's indispensable for any idea of justice. But how, this is the complex question that I've been negotiating with, that how do we assert our identity and recognition and dignity as Muslims without that identity becoming sectarian? So this is a question I think I fundamentally believe young Muslim women scholars should pick up. I have less hope from Muslim men, but young Muslim women academics, journalists, those in public life should pick up very seriously that how do we project, we have to assert, I'm totally in agreement with that, that that recognition, I think Muslim identity has been undignified, you know. A lot of this, I think, Swachh Bharat campaign also has to do in a very convoluted sense with some idea of Muslims and dirt and those colonies and massive reproduction. I mean, one has to see, one has to pause and see how powerful this regime is in terms of its symbolism. I mean, how are they getting it so spot on? I mean, this is mind-boggling. It's not about media. It's not about yogis. Power to know use. I mean, they are reckless. They will use violence, all that. But one has to see that. I'm watching Manisha Telangana so closely. You know that the state where they are coming for the first time. This is an ideal way to understand them. They have had very little presence. I can tell you the way they get their timing is so spot on. They will never indulge in violence when they are not sure that there is a consent for violence. We get lost in critiquing the violence. You know, these are violent, these are fascists, these are these. That's fine, that's okay, that critique should be there. But they know that they have to do spade work, they know that they have to build that consent, they know that they have to build those prejudices. And that's not an easy thing in a diverse society like India, which is, I mean, there's such humongous diversity. Imagination they're able to build among Hindus, which are so economically, socially, regionally, culturally diverse, that tells us that they have some deep civilizational understanding of this culture, what I'm referring to as cultural codes. You know, this idea of asceticism, this idea of social excess of political. They're using all of this and then projecting Muslims as this permanent other, you know, the question of pure impurity, all these things. So we'll have to take those, I think, cultural codes seriously. And I think this is not a, this should not be a predetermined question that how much should Muslims assert? Why will we not be Muslims? I don't think we have space for that kind of an abstract moral universalism. nothing like an abstract Muslim identity. This has to be tuned into, if we can get our cultural codes right and expand the space, obviously there will be more space for Muslims to sort of project their or live their identity more openly. But we'll have to get those spaces, and I don't see the counter narrative of Muslim politics, Muslim academics, or getting those cultural codes right. That's the question one can always ask. What do we do about those excesses of medieval time? I mean, Hindus are besieged by these questions, and I think we'll have to give up this fundamentally flawed analysis. I think you asked, somebody said 20 and 80. I think this is a fundamentally flawed modernist question. So what if we are 80? Why? Where is the law which says that 80% should not feel anxious? I just gave you that joke of a Muslim being beaten up, and he says, "Ab ye utke mujhe marega." Anxiety is not rational. I mean, post Freud, we have a subconscious. There are irrational phobias. There are irrational things that work. And those are constructed, those are manufactured, those are projected sometimes as phobia. There's a complex things going on, multiple things going on. So there is this secular assumptions that simply because the community is 80%, it doesn't have to be anxious. Simply because Muslim communalism will never come to power in India, it is not fascist. I mean, these old conventional left formulations, I don't think work in populist. No, we'll have to speak and think in populist registers and generate a thick, dense discourse that can counter, and that I think in one sense, I'm glad that difference in the academic sanitized social science categories, so populism is breaching those sanitized, right? Which is good. I feel that as academics, we should be challenged. Otherwise, we were happy to write in our referee journals, everything, sets, assumptions, provide some data sets, and then that's the end of the story. But today, no assumption is stable. Everything has been upturned. In fact, Manisha, my next piece in Telegraph, I argue that is there a possibility of a democratization by default by this majority regime? That they have forced open so many things that we could not ideally discover, like the gender question within Muslims was made so complex. But I think by wedging open, I think today the gender question is on the streets. So my own hunch, I mean, that's one possibility, I feel, that this majoritarianism might democratize society in a different way by default. But they have opened up question of smaller Dalit subcastes, smaller OBC subcastes. They might even democratize those Muslim women who sat for a few months in CA and Shaheen Bagh. I don't think will remain the same women when they go back home this time. Men might regret allowing them to be on streets for so long.
Right. That's a very interesting area, probably. And we are now forced to come out of our echo chambers, as you said, It was almost like I pat your back and you pat mine. And that world has been completely upturned. I think there are so many questions, Ajay. I don't think
But if there are any question from any Muslim, because representation is now such an important thing.
And we have a very good representation of Muslim students in our class.
That's a very interesting Muslim presentation. If somebody has any different sharp question, that's also interesting to me. It's also my interest. Don't want to answer the same thing over and over. I can't see the chat box. Suddenly seems to have disappeared from my. Is it here?
It's on the right side. People, and that's right side. There's a chat. You can see.
Is there a question you said, Manisha, by some Zainab?
Zainab, are you there? I think you've answered her question. You can look into Shweta Daya's question. She has slightly different.
I think I've already answered. Nothing interesting. Okay, I think we should call it a day maybe then, Manisha.
So wonderful. It's always been nice interacting with you, Ajay. And I think the virtual world has made it a little easier to get you. Otherwise, it would have been difficult to get you.
It's made it more cosmetic, but more easy also, actually. The number of talks I'm able to give now is more easy than sitting at home. You can But of course, you don't get to interact and learn as one used to. You know, in seminars, we meet a range of people. They come, sometimes they want in private, share a few things, about their anxieties, how things work. So that was a great learning experience for me, on the tours, on seminar touring.
So let's hope when the physical world resumes, then we can have you at SNDT maybe at some point of time.
Yes, it's wonderful. I would want to, given your social composition seems to be quite diverse and...
Thank you for sparing time for us. I do know that you have a lot of commitments, both writing commitments and speaking commitments. I'm so happy that you could spare time for our students. So once again, thank you so much. And who's officially giving the vote of thanks? We have Riddhi giving the vote of thanks. So, Riddhi?
Yeah. Yes, ma'am. Good afternoon, everyone. I am honored and lucky to have the opportunity to give a word of thanks on this special day. I particularly would like to thank our chief guest, Dr. Ajay Gudvardi, sir, where he mentioned the need for populism and protest in the webinar. The way in which he explained this subject was extraordinary. And I would like to thank all the professors who gave their valuable time and attend today's webinar. And today I must not to forget thanks Manisha ma'am, who helped us to encourage organizing such a wonderful webinar. Thank you so much, ma'am. And finally, I want to thank all the student teams and all the students who contributed to organizing this webinar for making this event successful. Thank you, ma'am. Thank you again. Thank you, sir.
Okay, let me also thank, on behalf of all of you, thank Manisha. She's a very conscientious and concerned teacher. She was after me that you should come and interact. I think you asked even 3 or 4 months back. I remember you said we have to come to class. So you're all lucky to have teachers like this. And hopefully, collectively, we will be able to realize a better time.
Yes.
These efforts of all kind, which have great integrity, I think will speak to the larger truth at some point in time.
Yeah, Ajay, can I make one more request? I'll ask all my students to switch on their camera. We don't have a group photograph in a physical world, would have been different, but we'll do something like a group photograph by switching on our cameras maybe.
Am I visible?
Yes, you are visible. Others, can you all please switch on your cameras? All the students, yeah, so that he can see you. Some may have left, yes. But the 45-50 were there.
Yeah. Whoever, outsiders, others, only your students are there, maybe.
Yeah, outsiders.
So good in one sense.
Riddhi, switch on your camera. Jibita. Taha.
These are all undergrad or postgraduate students?
They're first year of postgraduate, most of them, and second years also. Rimlina is second year.
Amen.
Right. I think in a physical world, you would have got far more sharper, you would have got tickled also, probably.
Yes, my learning has been scuttled. You know, I'm sharing thoughts, but I'm not able to learn back.
Yeah. Mariam, switch on. Vrishali. Thank you, everybody. Thank you so much.
Okay.
Yeah, we've done with a
good one.
Thank you. It was wonderful. Okay. And I think we should catch up sometime.
Yes, once the pandemic is over, we will definitely catch up either in Delhi or in Bombay. As I said, I'll be sending you an MPhil soon.
Oh,
for evaluation.
Okay. Okay. I have a student who is she started doing, I mean, she's just writing a proposal now. She's doing on Muslim women's protest, the anti-CA protest in Mumbai.
Oh, wonderful. Send me over the proposal. I'll be interested in writing.
Yeah, sure. I'll send you. And what else? We have other engagements today?
Tomorrow again, I'm giving a talk for National Law School, Orissa, on constitutional morality.
Constitutional morality. Okay.
Yeah, constitutional morality. I've titled it as Constitutional Morality, Populist Reality.
Oh, interesting.
It's interesting to engage the law guys.
And you're working on a new book?
Yeah, I'm working. It should be out with Rutledge, I think, on ethics and emotions in New India.
Okay.
Looking at all these questions, I'm talking about how ethics and emotions have been working. So just collection of all the short pieces I've written.
Okay.
Put them back in a book form.
That's the only good thing about pandemic. You have